Hello everyone, welcome to this session on radiological anatomy of thorax. In this particular session, we'll be discussing all the probable radiographs that you may be asked in practical examination. Okay, so let's begin. So these are the list of radiographs in thorax, out of which the chest X-ray posterior anterior view is the most frequently asked radiograph in exams, okay, and the other diagrams as well, chest X-ray antero posterior view, then contrast diagrams, this barium swallow is the most frequently asked, okay, then there is a procedure called as bronchogram, and lastly HRCT test, okay, so we'll see all these one by one. Let's begin with the chest X-ray posterior anterior view. So first of all, why the chest X-ray is required? For that, there are many indications that the patient may present with any trauma, or if you want to detect any congenital conditions, then if there is infection in the chest, for example tuberculosis, then degenerative, due to age there may be certain degenerative changes, then if there are cancerous conditions, neoplastic conditions. Okay, so there are many indications for prescribing a chest X-ray to a patient. Okay, so here we can see the chest X-ray. Usually R is written on the diagram. Most of the times we use the word X-ray and X-ray, but this film is actually called as diagram, or also it is also referred to as radiograph. Okay, these are the two correct terms which you should be using while describing the diagram in an exam. Okay, X-rays were the rays used to produce this film. Okay, but the film itself is called as diagram or radiograph. Okay, so once you know the indications for prescribing a chest diagram, you should also know how to prescribe a chest diagram. For example, you are sitting in a clinic and you want to prescribe the chest diagram to a patient. So how will you write in the prescription pad? So we can simply write as chest X-ray. Okay. At times it is also abbreviated as CXR. Okay. So this is how the prescription of the chest X-ray is given. Okay. Then you have prescribed this diagram. So patient presents you with this diagram. So the next step is how to read this diagram. Okay. So for that, we have a simplified proforma of how to read a diagram. So this is a plain diagram. So how to start reading this diagram? This is a plain diagram of one refers to the region, which region you are describing, and two is the view. Either it is anteroposterior view, or either it is postero anterior view, or there may be lateral and oblique views as well. Okay. Then showing which structures. So you should explain the structures one by one. Explain the bony tissue which is seen, the soft tissue which is seen, and the air shadows which are seen. Okay, so this ideal proforma you can remember. Okay, so this is a plain diagram. So this example is given here. You all can read this. This is a plain diagram of the chest, posterior anterior view, showing bony shadows of ribs, clavicle, vertebrae. So ribs, clavicle. Then in the midline there is vertebrae, and soft tissue shadows of heart, lungs, then domes of the diaphragm, then air shadows of lungs, trachea, fundus of the stomach. Okay, fundus of the stomach may have some air in this region. Okay, this is a very small view. Let's cover the chest diagram in detail. This is the chest diagram, posterior anterior view. Okay, so how to describe this diagram? This is a plain diagram, posterior anterior view of the chest region, showing bony shadows. So bones are, the ribs are visible. I'll change the color. So ribs are visible. Then clavicle bone is visible here. Then in the midline there is bodies of the vertebrae are visible. Okay, so bodies of the vertebrae are visible here. Then soft tissue shadow of the heart is visible, then air shadows of the lungs, Then air shadow will be here as well in many diagrams, the air shadow of the air in the fundus of the stomach. Okay. Then also air in the trachea, that is also visible here. And there are few specific structures which are to be described in a Plains diagram, that the region which is here, that this is referred to as the costophrenic angle, and the region here, this is referred to as the cardiophrenic angle. Okay, these two angles are important because in cases of pleural effusion, when the fluid gets filled between the parietal pleura and the visceral pleura, this angle gets obliterated first. Okay, so these are the indications in chest diagram that there is pleural effusion. So there will be blunting of this angle. Here we can see a sharp angle in pleural effusion. This angle may be like this. It will be blunted. Okay. Then in the cardiac shadow, borders of the heart are important. Structures forming the right border, structures forming the left border, that we'll see in subsequent slides. And in air shadow, the hilar shadow, which is seen here. Okay, this region is the hilum of the lung, from which the trachea divides into the various bronchi and enters into the lung. So bronchovascular markings are seen here. This white shadow is the bronchovascular marking, and at times there may be enlarged lymph nodes which may be seen here, the hilar lymph nodes. Okay. Then counting of the ribs is important. So here we can see this is the first rib, then second rib, third rib. Okay, so like this we have to count from posterior to anterior aspect. Okay, that's the ideal method for counting of the ribs. Then this is the scapula which is seen here. Then head of the humerus, the lateral end of the clavicle articulating with the acromion process of the scapula. So what all structures are visible, we will have to speak in the exam. Okay. Let's cover the cardiac border. Which structures form the right border of the heart? So from superior to inferior, if we see, there is right brachiocephalic vein. So this region shows the right brachiocephalic vein, then superior vena cava and right atrium. Okay, so these three structures are forming the right border of the heart. Let's see the structures forming the left border of the heart. So again, from superior to inferior, three structures are listed. One is the aortic knuckle. So it is the bending of the arch of aorta and continuing as the descending thoracic aorta. So that region is referred to as the aortic knuckle, that forms the left border of the heart, and there is left auricle and left ventricle. Okay, so three structures are marked here. And when we say right border and left border of the heart in radiology, it is the radiological right border and radiological left border. Okay, because in gross anatomy, while describing the border, structures are little different. Okay, so here when we describe, we should specifically say this is the radiological right border of the heart, this is the radiological left border of the heart. Okay, let's identify the various structures in this labeled image. So again, while describing the chest diagram, we should start in this manner. This is the Plains diagram, posterior anterior view of the chest region, showing bony shadows. So bones are the ribs, clavicle and all, scapula, then humerus. Okay, all these are the bones which are visible in the midline vertebral bodies. Okay. Then we should talk about the soft tissue shadows. The soft tissue, that's the heart, right border, left border. Then specific structures in the lung, the costophrenic angle, cardiophrenic angle, and also the domes of the diaphragm are labeled here. This is the right hemidiaphragm, this is the left hemidiaphragm. Right dome of the diaphragm is slightly at a higher level because the large liver which is present just below it. Okay. And here they have shown the spinous process of the vertebra. Ideally, the spinous process of the vertebra should be equidistant from the medial ends of the clavicle. Okay, so that diagram which we will say as this is a well centralized diagram. Okay. In cases of mediastinal shift, here we can see the air shadow which is seen, that is trachea. So air shadow will be deviated towards the right or towards the left, okay, depending upon the deviation of the mediastinum. Okay, for example, mediastinum, if it is deviated towards the right, what may be the probable causes? There may be some tumor from the left side which is pushing the mediastinum towards the right, okay, or else there may be fibrosis of this lung itself. So this lung shrinks, so the mediastinum is pulled towards that side. Okay, so there may be multiple reasons of shifting of the mediastinum, and mediastinal shift is identified by shifting of the air shadow of the trachea. Okay, then hilum is shown here, the right pulmonary hilum and the left pulmonary hilum. Okay, then if it is a female chest diagram, the breast shadow will be visible, so that also you can speak in the soft tissue shadows. So this was about the describing of the Plains diagram posterior-anterior view. So what all difference is there between a chest diagram of posterior-anterior view and chest diagram of antero-posterior view? In this image, we can see this is a posterior-anterior view and this image is a antero-posterior view. Okay, just take 2 seconds and try to differentiate. What major difference can you appreciate between these two diagrams? One major difference is the cardiac shadow. Okay, just appreciate the length of the cardiac shadow in a PA view and in AP view. Okay, there is spurious cardiomegaly which is seen in anteroposterior view. Okay, and this, the rays are passing from the anterior aspect and the plate is behind. Okay, so heart shadow is slightly enlarged in an anteroposterior view, whereas heart shadow is normal in posterior anterior view. Okay, because the plate is right in front of the chest and the rays are coming from behind, so exact size of the heart is seen clearly in posterior anterior view. Okay, and in antero posterior view, scapula obstructs the lung field. Can you appreciate this medial border of the scapula? This is the medial border of the scapula which is seen on each side. Okay, whereas in posterior anterior view, scapula is seen widely separated. Okay, so most of the time the skiagram posterior anterior view is recommended. Antero posterior view is done in very rare cases. For example, there is a critical patient who cannot come to the x-ray room and go for the x-ray. Okay, so for a critical bedridden patient, portable x-ray is done and the x-ray is passed from the anterior aspect towards the posterior aspect, so that is an AP view. Okay, and in children's also AP view may be taken. Okay, the most common indication is the critical patient for AP view. So this was about differences between posterior anterior view and antero posterior view, and in this diagram the basic difference which we will see is the difference in the size of the cardiac shadow, and the scapula will be seen here, the medial margin of the scapula that will obstruct the lungs. There is a separate slide on counting of the ribs. So the ribs are counted from posterior to anterior aspects. First rib, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. Okay, so this diagram shows counting of the ribs. We should count from posterior to anterior aspects. And there is something called as cardiothoracic ratio. It is the cardiac shadow compared with the shadow of the entire thorax. Okay, ideally it is 0.5 or less than that. Okay, if it is increased, cardiothoracic ratio, if it is increased, that means it is cardiomegaly. Okay, for example, if this is 5 cm and this is 10 cm, just for example, 5 by 10 is 0.5, right? If the cardiac shadow is 7 cm and this is 10, so this will be more than 0.5. that means it is cardiomegaly. Okay, that's how cardiothoracic ratio is important to determine whether there is cardiomegaly or not. Okay. Now let's cover the contrast diagrams of the thorax. So this is the most frequently asked contrast diagram. It's the barium swallow. Okay, you might have also learned about the barium meal, barium follow through. Okay, these are the various steps in the barium procedure. Okay, the patient is asked to eat the barium based suspension. Okay, and when he swallows it, the X-ray films are taken. So that is referred to as barium swallow. And in barium swallow, esophagus is seen. And when the barium reaches the stomach, the X-ray films are taken. So that X-ray film will be referred to as barium meal. Okay. And when the barium reaches the small intestine, that will be referred to as barium follow through. Okay. And when the barium is passed through the large intestine, through the rectum, it is referred to as barium enema. Okay. In which the barium is directly pushed through the rectum. Okay. So let's see the barium swallow. So in barium swallow, you'll be asked about the esophagus. So you'll have to identify the esophagus. Then the various curvatures of the esophagus may be asked. Okay. So various curvatures as well as constrictions of the esophagus. Okay. Let's see the constrictions of the esophagus. There are four constrictions which are described. One is the cervical constriction, then aortic constriction, then bronchial constriction and diaphragmatic constriction. Okay. And these distances from the upper incisor teeth, these are important because while passing a gastric tube or a Ryle's tube, these distances are measured and we'll have to take precautions while the gastric tube passes through these levels. Okay. So cervical constriction is 6 inches from the incisor teeth, aortic constriction is 9 inches from the incisor teeth, bronchial constriction is 11 inches from the incisor teeth, and diaphragmatic constriction is 15 inches from the incisor teeth. Okay, these are the constrictions, and also there are curvatures in the esophagus. Curvatures are two left sided curvatures, when it passes through the thoracic inlet. Okay, and one when it crosses the descending thoracic aorta. Okay, so these two left sided curvatures are there in esophagus and there are four constrictions. Okay, constrictions are narrowing of the esophagus. Let's cover the next contrast diagram. This is referred to as bronchogram. In this, an endotracheal tube may be passed inside the trachea or a catheter may be passed inside the trachea and iodine based dye are injected directly into the trachea so that the contrast material spreads out. Okay. So this is a little invasive procedure, so it is not done nowadays. It's an old procedure, but in some colleges this diagram may be kept in practical examination. So if such type of diagram is shown, then you will have to label it as bronchogram. Okay. And in this viva question, you may be asked about the bronchial tree and the bronchopulmonary segment. Okay. So this I've just included for the sake of covering. In clinical practice nowadays, it is not performed because advanced techniques like CT scans are now available. Okay. So HRCT is the most advanced technique to study the lung fields. So multiple sections will be taken and the lung shadow will be studied. And while studying the CT scan, we should remember that all views which are seen, those are seen from the inferior aspect. Okay. So if I have to give orientation to this image, this is anterior, posterior, this is the left side and this is the right side. Okay. CT scan, MRI sections are viewed as if you are viewing it from the inferior aspect. Okay. So while studying gross anatomy sections, try to read sections which are shown from the inferior aspect, so you will be able to easily correlate those sections with the HRCT scan or any MRI scan. Okay, this is the left lung and this is the right lung. Okay, this is the cardiac shadow which is seen. This is the vertebral body. So this is the lung field which is seen, and the branching of the bronchi. Okay. So let's summarize what we have covered in this particular session. So we have covered the plain chest diagram in detail. So there may be multiple views in this. AP and PA view we covered. Most frequently asked is the PA view, and the most frequently which you will describe for patient is the PA view. Okay, and then there may be lateral and oblique views as well. Okay. And whenever there is a chest diagram, we should be able to identify the trachea, the various cardiac borders, aortic knuckle, okay, and the two angles, cardiophrenic, costophrenic angle, the bronchovascular markings, hilar lymph nodes if present, then breast shadows in female, the two domes of the diaphragm, then should be able to count the ribs. Then these were the contrast diagrams, barium swallow bronchogram, and this is the latest technique, that is the CT scan. Okay. This was all about this particular session. So if you all want PDF handout, you all can request me at this WhatsApp number, and please do watch other sessions of this YouTube channel. Okay. Thank you.